Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Oxford Union for the first event of 2016. Tonight, we are asking ourselves the most topical of questions, both within Oxford and without. Must Rhodes fall? We have an expert panel here tonight, and you can find more information on the speakers in the programmes on your seats. Working from my right to my left, we have Ntokozo Qwabe, Yasmin Kumi, Athinangamso and Nkopo, Professor Richard Drayton, Professor William Beinart, Professor Nigel Biggar, and Sophia Cannon. The format for the discussion will be as follows. Each speaker on the panel will have a maximum of 2 minutes and 30 seconds for their opening statement. I will ring the bell once at 2 minutes and twice at 2 minutes 30. I will then ask follow-up questions to prompt a general discussion among the panelists on the points that are raised. This will be followed by as many questions as possible from the audience. Please wait to be recognised by me, and for the microphone to be handed to you by Noah before asking your question. After the general discussion, each speaker will have a maximum of 2 minutes for their closing statement. I will ring the bell once at 1 minute 30 seconds and twice at 2 minutes. All members will then vote with their feet on the question, must Rhodes fall? With those saying yes, walking out the door marked ayes, and those saying no, walking out of the door marked noes. If you are in the gallery, you will also be allowed to vote and will be instructed as you walk down the stairs as to where you need to walk in order to indicate your decision. With that, I look to Ntokozo Qwabe for your opening statement.
Thank you, Stuart. Thank you very much. Stuart, before just getting into my opening statement, I would like to dispose of a particular matter which I think is important, and that is that the space that we are in and the space that we are required to hold this debate is not neutral. This space last year declared itself institutionally racist, and we think that the fact that a debate about colonial legacy and about institutional racism is taking place in a space that is in itself institutionally racist is a problematic that we must engage as we continue this debate. But I do want to say that I do want to urge you as we debate this tonight to pay attention to not only the polarized statue debate that is going on and that has been presented in the media as our only demand or our only mission as Rhodes Must Fall. We have a broad program that we are advocating for at Oxford, and that interrogates how patterns of exclusion function at Oxford. We are interrogating the exclusion of black and minority ethnic voices in the curriculum. We are interrogating the ways in which Oxford remains a space that is exclusive to black professors, for example. We don't think that an Oxford University that purports to be inclusive in the 21st century can only have one full-time black professor. We think there's something deplorable about that. And we are raising these issues using the statue as an emblem under which we are sparking the debate. We are also talking about other things relating to the composition of the student body. We find it deplorable that there are only 24 black British students that have been accepted for last year into the undergraduate student body, simply because Oxford, only selects its students from particular elite private schools and some public schools. And we think there is a statement to be made about how structures of exclusion persist at Oxford, and that is what I would urge you to engage going forward. The broad goals of the movement that we have articulated in the democratic general assemblies that we've held at Oxford, and yes, it's not just about the statue, and I'm hoping for substantive engagement tonight on the broad issues that we are raising.
Thank you very much, Ntokozo. I now turn to Yasmin Kumi for your opening statement.
Thank you. I'm going to remain seated because it's much more comfortable now that we started the trend. What I want to strongly highlight tonight is 3 points. First, it's personally clear to me that the necessity to remove the statue is inevitable. Secondly, I think, equally to what Ntokozo said, that the debate tonight should be about a broader issue, which is institutional racism and the decolonization of education within Oxford, a topic that we urgently need to talk about. The third point I'm going to make is that Rhodes Must Fall is not a movement of a minority of black students. It's actually a movement across skin color that demands all of us to engage, and I hope that each and every single person of you in this room is going to engage with it tonight. Now, why do I think that the statue debate is actually a no-brainer for me? I think that because we're asking the question whether Rhodes must fall. When we say must, we actually call upon conventions within our society that allow us to refer to something as an obligation, that allow us to say whether something is wrong or whether something is right. To me, it's evident that a leader who led the ideology of the century-long supremacy of the Anglo-Saxon race, such as Rhodes, does not deserve the glorification through an elevated statue at Oxford University, despite the fact that he has rendered money into scholarships. As a half-German, I can assure you that we do not have a single statue of Hitler in our country, despite the money he invested into infrastructural systems we are benefiting from until date. Yes, I'm comparing Rhodes and Hitler, not because I have counted the lives they have taken, but because the danger of their crimes lied in their racist ideologies. Now, how does the Africa society that I'm speaking for tonight view this debate? You know, to be honest, we have quite a strong representation of students from West Africa in the Africa society. Quite a few of them are not active members of Rhodes Must Fall, Oxford. Rhodes' footprint mainly was in Southern Africa. The identification with Rhodes as an image is not as straightforward for non-Southern African students. But if you ask them whether they think that there's a problem about colonized education in Oxford or a problem with institutional racism in Oxford, they would all have their stories to share. Which is why our members voted last term that 90% of them are supportive of collaborating with Rhodes Must Fall on selected issues. So here I'm standing saying that I think what has to fall the most is institutional racism in Oxford, and I'm happy to give more examples about that later in our debate. What I would like to say at last is what I experienced about the movement and why I'm saying it's not a black movement. At the protest in Michaelmas term in front of Oyo College, we had more white participants than black participants. A minority cannot free itself from being suppressed in one or the other way in an education institution like Oxford. It demands that the majority is equally engaging, which is why I'm sitting here tonight to engage with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Yasmin. I now turn to Athinangamso Nkopo for your opening statement.
Thank you. It's true that the statue is, for us as Rhodes Must Fall, emblematic of something that's a lot more problematic and perhaps more damning to the experience of black and minority students who are in this environment. But the statue itself is, as a result, then very important for us to interrogate and for us to do a way up, considering how it is that statues function in society. We think that statues function to reflect the ways in which institutions, societies imagine themselves. And being that Oxford University has all of these structural problems we put before you, we think that them having a statue of Cecil John Rhodes overlook us on High Street at the entrance of Oriel College on a pedestal is very problematic, considering that when Oxford broadcasts itself to the world, it says it is open, it is inclusive, it is a leading 21st century global institution. We think then, what Max Price says at the removal of the Rhodes statue at UCT in Cape Town is really important, that the position of Rhodes statue on UCT campus said something about the values of that university. So this ought to be a debate about, at least insofar as the statue is concerned, the ways in which Oxford University wants to portray itself and the ways in which it imagines itself. Putting a plaque next to it, putting a sign under it, is very difficult to engage when that statue stands in living color, life size, above us all on High Street. Because in societies, statues are to commemorate, are to glorify those people whose ideas and whose actions have given us a way through which to travel history as we imagine ourselves to be. So the way up for Oxford University in terms of keeping the statue there or removing the statue is about saying how the university wants to imagine itself and the ways in which its configuration affects the lives of those people affected by empire all throughout the Global South. We urge you in this debate to think very carefully about what it is that the university has to lose when it removes that statue and replaces it with someone or something that we can all be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I now turn to Professor Richard Drayton for your opening statement.
I admire Rhodes. I fully confess it. And when his time comes, I shall buy a piece of the rope for a keepsake. So said Mark Twain. Rhodes's contemporaries thought him at best a scoundrel, stock manipulator, briber, bully, and at worst a criminal. Lecky suggested he should be jailed. Rhodes, Chesterton wrote, invoked slaughter, violated justice, and ruined republics. In 1899, almost 100, including the Master of Balliol, both proctors, the Librarian of Bodley, and the cream of intellectual Oxford, including Mr. Bigger's predecessor and the Chair of Theology, signed a memorial against Rhodes receiving an honorary degree. Contrary to what you've heard, the best spirits of his age held Rhodes in a contempt equal to our own. But these voices were written out of history by the free speech of Rhodes's money. Even more silenced were the tens of thousands of African victims of his regime. Rhodes did not give to Oxford. He sought to buy its soul. He sought to launder his reputation, and there were enough venal dons to take his blood diamonds. He and his proxies paid for memorials, portraits, and statues for him on a Stalinist scale. Many contemporaries thus saw the 1911 new buildings of Oriel, with Rhodes above kings and bishops, sneering across at the university church, as vulgar, if not idolatrous, with Evelyn Waugh in 1930 urging it be dynamited. So what we have there on the high street as a statue is a piece of PR in stone, an expression of a minority party interest in dubious taste, which was foisted onto 20th century Oxford. But the case for Rhodes falling is not about the past, but the present. Look at your classrooms, common rooms, curricula. Talk to a representative group of people of color, if you can even find one in your college, about their experiences here. Oxford, with its best liberal intentions, remains color-coded white. And the complacency with which Oxford and Britain face their racial and colonial pasts is quite central to this. We have a right and a duty to change Oxford. Every country in Europe other than Britain, not just Germany, not just Russia, but France, and Spain, and Italy, and Portugal have removed statues and renamed streets in order to free the future from symbolic slavery to past evils. Oriel's Road similarly belongs behind a museum glass rather than the high. There is a poetic sweetness that the Rhodes scholarships, through which Rhodes intended to diffuse the despotic culture of British imperialism to the world, has instead become the spur for Oxford and Britain to question that past and to begin to free themselves towards the future.
Thank you very much for that, Professor. I now turn to Professor William Beinart for your opening statement.
Thank you. I welcome the debate initiated by Rhodes Must Fall, but I consider the statue also as a secondary issue. For me, the central question is, how can we deal with the legacy of Rhodes in the academic sphere? Oxford has benefited enormously for over a century from the Rhodes Trust, as well as other money generated by mining magnates largely in Southern Africa. And this debate for me is about the long-term relationship created. I believe the university as a whole should consider the responsibilities that arise from accepting such donations. I want to suggest a route that I think can find wide support and looks to the future. Oxford has in fact undergone huge changes in recent decades. And at the postgraduate level trains a large number of African students and students with expertise on Africa. And two centers have been established, but decision making is very devolved. And in some ways, that's our genius, but we don't think across the institution. I think we do have to do that now. The trust has been used as a general fund. It's globalized the studentships. They have put money into the Mandela Rhodes Scholarships in Southern Africa, but I think that greater priority needs to be given in the university to students, scholarships for students from Africa, and to ensuring that Oxford is a leading center for the study of Southern Africa and Africa in the world, certainly in Britain. Oriel and other colleges who've directly benefited over the years from the trust money should consider scholarships. The future of the Rhodes Chair of Race Relations, which I held, I'm now retired, should be made more certainly a Chair of African Studies. And this can be an exciting moment for syllabus revision, as history is recently doing. I suggest we have a summit on Africa, as it was a few years back on China studies. With respect to the statue, I recognize the students' strategic acumen in choosing this symbolic battleground. They probably wouldn't have attracted the same attention if they wanted to revise the English syllabus. And I believe that the priority, nevertheless, is not what should fall. It's rather what might rise, the positive and concrete academic developments that could be furthered by this debate.
Thank you, Professor, for your opening statement. I now turn to Professor Nigel Biggar for your opening statement.
First of all, if we insist on our heroes being pure, we aren't going to have any. Last year, the shine on Mahatma Gandhi's halo came off when we learned of his views that Indians were culturally superior to black Africans. Does that mean we should forget his remarkable achievements? I don't think so. Second, claims that Rhodes was South Africa's Hitler and carried out genocide lack any historical foundation. Third, Rhodes was not racist. He didn't hold black Africans in general contempt. He did not view them as biologically inferior and incapable of cultural development. In 1899, he defended the right of blacks to vote. He stipulated that his scholarships be awarded regardless of race. And the first Rhodes Scholarship was awarded to an African American within 5 years of his death. Fourth, while often ruthless in his choice of means, Rhodes was a prodigious entrepreneur who used his wealth for public purposes. Unlike some of South Africa's current rulers, he didn't use it to feather his own nest. Rather, to develop the region's economy and to build a worldwide community of public leaders through his scholarship legacy. Fifth, if Rhodes must fall, so must Churchill, whose views on empire and race were much the same. And so probably must Abraham Lincoln. While Lincoln liberated African-American slaves, he doubted they could be integrated into a white society and favored their separate development, their segregation, or apartheid, if you will, in an African colony. Finally, in 2010, the ANC government in KwaZulu-Natal, in South Africa, named a new airport after King Shaka. Shaka was responsible for forging a highly militaristic Zulu empire in the early 1800s, for waging terroristic and genocidal wars, not least in 1826, and for a share of the deaths of between 1 and 2 million black Africans. If Shaka gets to stand in Durban, Rhodes, whose sins pale by comparison, should be left standing in Oxford.
Thank you very much, Professor, for your opening statement. I now turn finally to Sophia Cannon for your opening statement.
There is a clear moral, economic, and indeed historical distinction between the statue which is on your high street and, shall we say, the objet d'art that found its way briefly onto eBay, such as chains from slavery, uniforms from the Holocaust, or recently the debate that has continued in the States on the Confederate flag. And it's very different, is it not, when you have people peddling currency based upon shame, racism, and indeed misery. The statue outside, I say, wasn't erected like we see on the continent in a cult of personality. We don't do that here. In Britain, our statues are welded to our history, whether we like it or not. Now, it's no accident that I'm here on this side. And indeed, it's no accident that I'm here with an English name, both front and back. Because the African diaspora reaches far and wide. And in the Caribbean, our history is genetic. We have ginger-haired, green-eyed, freckled black children, as do I, and my sister, my aunt. What is crucial to know is that the critical nucleus of minds that we have on the right, in 50 years' time, their statues should be here, and their legacy should be as great, because the problems that the African diaspora face need to be challenged, and indeed, the only way it can be done today is through the academic mind. Rhodes must not fall today.
Sophia, thank you very much for your opening statement. We'll now move on to, as I said, a few minutes of questions from me as follow-up before moving to the audience for questions from you. Yasmin, I just wanted to pick up on one thing that you said. You said this is the Rhodes Must Fall movement and people who are in support of the movement is much broader than just black and minority ethnic people. And that may well be true. The recent Cherwell survey by Charles' newspaper in Oxford, said that 54% of those surveyed did not want the statue to come down. If this is a view that is shared by the majority of students at the university, should we respect that democratic decision and not take the statue down?
So, you know, I've actually read about that survey and I had thought of quoting it in what I was saying in my opening statement. At the end of the day, majorities are always relative. And I would probably ask a counter question and say, would you want to keep a statue that 46% of the students within the entire university have a problem with? Because that's nearly half of the entire student body, and this is a big university. So I don't think that you can just ignore that huge amount of students that actually said that they don't find it right to maintain the statue where it is. And I think what we also need to consider here is that removing the statue can take completely different shapes and formats. There's all kinds of different options, from completely taking the statue down and destroying it to moving it into a museum. We have enough museums in Oxford. And that would probably be a good compromise, because the ones that said that they don't want the statue to be removed can go to the museum.
I would very much like to respond to Mr. Bigger. I'm sure that if Mr. Bigger heard me trying to explain to you the doctrine of transubstantiation, the hairs would stand on the back of his neck at the appalling oversimplifications and errors which I'd be making. And I have to say that as a professional historian, I'm simply appalled to hear Mr. Bigger speak to you in precisely these terms on the basis of God knows what reading he happens to have done last night or the night before. I mean, the oversimplifications are just, where does one begin? That the Rhodes Scholarship was open to all races. By all races, Rhodes meant Afrikaner or English in South Africa. That was quite clear. Rhodes, in fact, had no control over the appointment of Alain Locke, who was quite a pale-skinned man, it has to be said, too. And you have to look very hard for your Rhodes scholars of color before quite late in the 20th century. I think the first black Bermudan sent as a Rhodes scholar was not till the 1970s. I can recall meeting the first black president of the Oxford Union, a Barbadian man called Cameron Tudor, later on Sir James Tudor. He described his experiences in Oxford in the 1940s of being racially abused in the street and then coming in here and to find these fresh-faced boys having to look up to him as he sat in the presidential chair. At the same time, in the interwar period, Eric Williams could not even go to a proper college because the colleges at Oxford did not have people of color in them. You had to go to a non-collegiate society. Certainly Oriel or Christchurch, Mr. Bigger's college, would never have had a person of color as a member of its student body. This idea that somehow there's this kind of post-racial utopia created by Rhodes and Oxford, it's quite a perverse proposition.
Thank you for that, Professor Drayton. I suppose Professor Bigger could, Professor Bigger, will you please respond to that?
Yes, of course, the question of what was meant by the word race in Rhodes' final 1899 will is controversial. Some people like Richard Drayton, Drayton, think that the word race has to refer only to the racial divide between Afrikaner and English. The problem with that interpretation is that this will was drafted in England, not South Africa. In England, the word race refers to ethnicity. It doesn't refer to Afrikaners at all. That's one problem. The second problem is this, that in 1896, at the end of the Second Matabele War, which appears to have changed Rhodes's views on his priorities in South Africa, he told a companion that he would make building confidence between black and white in South Africa one of his main projects. And when asked in 1899 what he meant, he was asked, he made a statement about equal rights for all civilized men south of Zambezi. He was challenged on what he meant by civilized, and he said, black or white. We cannot presume that the word race, written in England in 1899, meant Afrikaner.
Sir, can I?
Yes, please.
I hope that this debate is not going to be about whether or not Rhodes was a racist and committed all of these acts. Because if what you want to interrogate are the things that he said, you must look at the things that he did. So he may have said all civilized men, talking about black or white, but he also made sure that 9 out of 10 black people would be laboring and enslaved by his companies in South Africa. What he also made sure would happen is that they would be dispossessed of land so that they couldn't fulfill all of the criteria that you needed to be able to stand in this position. And he killed hundreds upon thousands of them, right? So I don't think that this debate, like, we can go on arguing whether or not Rhodes is a racist in the first place when he himself published many things in the Cape, in the newspapers that he oversaw, which demonstrated his attitudes towards African people when he had them killed, and when he said he prefers land to niggers. It's indicative, this debate, like this angle is indicative of this denialism of what happens to African people in Southern Africa. It's actually structured around denying the experiences that we have here in the first place, but also denying what happened there and results in us being taking the position that we do take against Rhodes. But it wants to remove the debate from being about the bigger picture, which is white supremacy, which is about racism and the ways that it continues to affect people's lives.
Thank you. So if you don't mind, if we could move on, I'm sure someone else will pick this up in the questions, so we'll leave it till then. I just wanted to pick up, Sophia, on something you had said. You said that taking down the statue was not something we could equate to the selling of slave chains and things like that. Could you just pick up on that? And also with reference to something that you have said before, which is that the removal of the statue the Rhodes statue is something that we could equate to the removal of statues by ISIS?
I think the whole idea is, if we start removing our statues, where do we stop? And how do we go about doing it? What criteria do we set? Do we go by plebiscite and the majority rule? Or do we decide what is immoral and what is amoral, or indeed when morality shifts and changes? I think for me, my concern is I want my children's children to see this statue and know who he is. If you erase your history, you erase both the bright lights and the dark spots. We need this statue here so that you can point to it and shout shame at it. But if you remove it, then the whole issue of the interracial society, and it will be interracial.
Issue of erasing history.
Sophia, can we just, you know, get over this narrative already that somehow statues are places that we go to learn about history? I don't see Oxford students standing outside Oriel and asking that statue. In fact, what we are saying is that that statue as it stands constitutes an erasure of history, because it does not say anything about what Rhodes did. All it does say is to thank him for his munificent contribution. And there's no interrogation of where that contribution came from.
Yes,
so there's an erasure that's happening then. We are saying that the fact that some British people have come out in the media saying that they never even noticed the statue points exactly to that problem, that it's not actually a source of learning and a source of, you know, finding out about historical facts.
So then, if I may, what about the idea of having a plaque that educates, which has been dismissed on this side of the panel? Would that serve that purpose and keep the statue where it is?
Well, can I just come back on that? One of the problems we've got is that in Britain, I think the figures were that last year, only 3 black teachers chose history as an elective to teach in British schools. I was schooled somewhere in Shield Forest, and I remember having slave history taught to me, and I was the only black child in school, and I had to go and find my own history. Now, can it be right that in many urban centres in this country, that history, again, is being taught by a very limited few graduates? So I agree with you, but taking the statue down says more about the removal than leaving it there and having it supported by a correct history. I'm very grateful for this movement, because it's got children talking, finally, about why they're here. Why are the Caribbean peoples here? Why are the African peoples here? We didn't just show up overnight during the war. Our history goes back 400 years. It goes back to the sugar. It goes back to the plantations. It goes back to the docks. And my God, it goes back to Regent Street, our country houses. We need to have a new history, but taking down what we've got is not the solution.
Thanks, Ntokozo. If you could just address the point of the plaque.
Yes, no. The reason why I reject contextualization is, how do you contextualize Rhodes? What do you say? You know, racist, genocidal maniac? I guess that would work, but for us, we think contextualization is often a way of actually obfuscating the actual issue that Rhodes is there. There is this attempt to add Mandela, for example, as a voice alongside Rhodes to sanitize some of his crimes and to say, well, you know, Mandela was able to forgive Rhodes, as if Mandela is the god of all black people. And this is what we are pointing out, that we cannot, if Oxford is committed to its intellectual tradition and the tradition of rigor that it expresses, then we cannot be reduced, when we then pursue that inquiry, to one person's views. All of us must be Mandela. You know, all of us must take this sort of narrow view of history. Now, we are saying that contextualization is problematic simply because of what we're seeing right now, for example, at Oriel College, where they've apparently contextualized the statue, but all they've done is added a pathetic A4 piece of paper, which we think, you know, and they say, you know, we disagree with the views of Rhodes, as if we're talking about views and not crimes. They talk about, you know, disagreeing with his political statements, but they don't say what those were. Are we talking about white supremacy, perhaps? Is that what you disagree with? And that's what I think that's why we are against contextualization, because we think it doesn't go to the root of the issue.
Thank you very much, Ntokozo. Is it okay if we move to audience questions? So now we're moving to audience questions. If anyone does have a question, please raise your hand high in the air, wait for me to recognize you, and then Noah will come round with the microphone. So we will start with the gentleman in the glasses. In that, yeah.
Hi, good evening, thanks for coming. I just want to preface this by saying that I come from the United States, I come from a multiracial background, and I agree in principle with the movement's ends. I agree that Oxford is a place that is remarkably, well, let's just say, of one particular side or of one particular class. It ends up being that way. I live that reality, I understand it, and I agree that there should be more diversity. But at the same time, I'm for freedom. That's my life, that's what I believe in. And I think Ms. Nkopo, is that it? You said that societies imagine themselves through the statues, through the symbols that they use. And I personally believe that's right. But at the same time, isn't that just your own interpretation of what a statue might mean to someone? In that sense, can I not see the statue and say, here is Cecil John Rhodes, a man who by the imperial boot and by plunder made a part of this world his own domain? But can I not also say, here is Cecil John Rhodes, a man who did all these things, and now I know that I shouldn't do these things because they're wrong. They're a reminder of what you shouldn't do. Or in some cases, some people will say he's someone to be regarded as a successful British man, a good imperialist.
You.
They can say that too.
But by
actually destroying the statue, putting it somewhere where no one will see it, aren't you limiting our free speech to make our own interpretation, to make those decisions for our own selves, to learn from what they did wrong?
Yes, thank you for your question. Thank you. Athi, would you care to respond, as the question was largely directed at you?
Sure. It absolutely isn't my own interpretation that statues serve this purpose that you repeat. When you look around in this room, you don't expect that any of the heads of these men are Nazi generals. And you most probably won't go to them and read them. The reason why in the House of Commons some of the politicians there admitted that they had never seen the statue is because this education that you propose is supposed to happen at the plaque under Cecil John Rhodes is in fact an education that doesn't happen. And anyone with the kind of vigor you demonstrate to make interpretations about history, to make their own decisions and engage in free speech is somebody who's willing to put his name on Google and discover all of those things and unlikely to walk past him hoisted above saints at High Street and engage that that history freely. But I think the invocation of the word history in this debate has also been one that's problematic, that doesn't actually engage what it is that we're talking about when we do say history. Because we say it's an opportunity to study history as though that's actually what statues can do, right? But what we do actually mean is it's an opportunity to demonstrate a single side of history. That is what limits free speech as far as we're concerned. It's the fact that the Chancellor of the university has said anyone who wants to propose that Rhodes must fall must go somewhere else. We think that is the limitation of free speech. That's when we're not able to have the interrogation you desire. And that's where there's no generosity of spirit towards a more reflexive history for an institution as prestigious as Oxford.
Thanks for that response, Ed. Thank you. If I could throw it over to Professor Beinart for your response.
Sorry, I didn't express myself about the statue because I considered it secondary. If I were the Queen or the forthcoming King, which of course I never will be, I, following Richard's comments, might well want to see the statue go it is extraordinary that Rhodes stands above two kings of England with a foot on the head of both of them. And he is surrounded, or they are surrounded. He's in the top tier, and then on the second tier, there's four provosts of Oriel, all religious men. And if I was Simon Sharma, an art historian, trying to interpret what I was seeing, I would say that this is the sanctification of money over blood or inheritance, birth. However, so I mean, it is interesting. And I would nevertheless see a little bit of a contradiction in some of the points that have been raised on this side, is that fundamentally the statue has allowed you to get where you've got, and yet you believe that it has no significance. And for me, this is, statues do have historical significance, and they do have power, and you've shown exactly how that in a movement one can reinterpret history through images and through symbols. And as I say, you probably couldn't have done it through the English syllabus. So be careful what you take away, because you take away a weapon for yourselves as well. Thirdly, if I could just come on to this point, it is correct. Where do we stop? How do we consider this? And I'm trying to think about consistency here. Everybody in late Victorian England, despite what Richard says, or very many people, were implicated in colonialism and imperialism. Rhodes got his charter by an act of the British government. They could easily not have given it. Queen Victoria had the opportunity, when there were emissaries from the Ndebele, not to recognize the Rudd concession on which the charter was based for Zimbabwe. She didn't. So, and I could go on.
Thank you. Professor.
And I think that this is the crux, is do we then dispense with all statues from that age, or do we use them as a medium to think with? And I'll try to illustrate that further if I get another chance.
Thank you, Professor. Professor Drayton, you want to say something?
I think it's very important that we make a distinction between free speech and public space. Free speech is a civic right, and free speech and free opinions, this is something which we all, you may hold whatever opinions you wish, and I would like to think that a student in Oxford who asks for a statue to come down should have the right to do so without being abused by the chancellor of their university. I think that Mr. Patton's contribution to this debate is simply shocking. But there's a distinction between free speech and public space. Public space is shared. And public spaces are not things that are set in aspic, preserved forever. Public spaces in every city in the world is continually being reinvented, repurposed. Things are taken away, they are moved, they are relocated. Things are given new facades. Things are made ready for the future. And this is essentially what the claim of Rhodes Must Fall is about. It's about Oxford, in fact, confronting. And this is why, in fact, all these comparisons with, statues of Churchill, Mahatma Gandhi, this is complete red herrings. We are talking about Oxford and a statue that sits at the absolute center of this university and which symbolizes white domination, which symbolizes the rights of minorities to rule over majorities without their consent. And we are celebrating that. And I'm appalled, I'm simply astounded that there are people who can choose to defend Cecil Rhodes. It's one thing to defend the right of the statue to remain, but I'm simply astonished that in 21st century Oxford, there are people who are attempting to actually mount a defense of Cecil Rhodes.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you. the second question. If we could, and in the air, yes, we'll go to the lady who's coming out of her seat over there.
Good afternoon. My name's Deborah Ohm. I'm currently a student at the Business School. Thank you all for your remarks this evening. I heard some fantastic contributions, and I also heard a lot of flawed remarks. One of the things that I would like to say is that there are black teachers in the UK who are teaching history. They ran a conference last year, and there were over 50 of them, and they're going to continue to teach history to black students, white students, Asian students, and all coloured students in the UK. The next thing that I would like to just talk about is the shocking statistics I heard here today around the amount of professors there are. Now, in the UK, there are 18,510 professors. Of those professors, 85 are black and only 18 are women. To me, that's shocking. To me, that's a problem. To me, that's something that we should be talking about here this evening. And I would like for us to just take the debate back to that conversation about the institutionalized racism that happens in the education system here in the UK. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I think we'll throw it over to Sophia.
So just to answer that, just for clarity, so only last year, the new cohort, only 3 black graduates elected for history. So I took that straight from the Guardian website because I wanted to find out why, at the age that I am, who is teaching history? Why did not everybody else know about Rhodes? I knew about Rhodes, but I again took that aside and wanted to know why we're here. I just need to add something which I tweeted about 4 years ago. I found out which family in the UK owned my family in Dominica. Couldn't believe it, because we actually share the same agent. I say no more than that. Does that make any sense to anybody? So there's a very famous family who owned my family. And now, after all these years, we have that opportunity to discuss our legacy. And the option is to go back to the plantation where my ancestors came from, and indeed his.
Thank you. Yasmin, you wanted to answer the...
So, Sophia, I appreciate that additional insight, but I think the most important thing that Deborah has brought out here that we are actually really, really, really keen on is to discuss what solutions can be to the fact that we don't have enough black professors in the academic body here, that we don't have enough African students here or students that are black or from other minorities, and that at the moment we don't really understand how this is being tackled in all kinds of different institutions within the university. And it would be really great if we could dedicate a part of this evening to talking about these solutions, because the reason why we're sitting here is not because we want to talk about whether Rhodes was racist or not, what the statue means or what it doesn't mean, whether someone stands in front of it for longer to think about it or not. It's about the broader issue of institutional racism. And we want to make sure that there's a more equal representation in all kinds of different parts of this university by, for instance, saying, okay, we're going to pull up a new working group that is attached to the central body of the university that comprises students from this movement, that comprises students from the different African societies, from other societies that represent ethnical minorities, in order to find ways to address this. I've done an NSC in African Studies last year, and I was nearly not sure whether I'm going to come here, because I knew that if I do the degree here, there's not going to be a single black African professor that is going to teach me, even though I'm studying African Studies. Thankfully, it was still a good experience, but it's weird if you talk about such a topic without ever having a black African professor speaking to you. This cannot happen in Oxford University. We need to change this, and we need to change it now.
I suppose that leads on to the question, though, that it seems that while the issue of whether the statue should fall or not is so divisive, far more people seem to be in favour of doing exactly what we're saying, looking to diversify the faculty in particular. Why do we not then focus on that as the main issue? And why is the Rhodes Must Fall campaign so obviously, as it says in the name, focused on the statue coming down? Ntokozo.
Well, I don't think you can separate the issue of underrepresentation from the issue of how the space itself is designed. We have pointed out a number of times that a lot of these issues around exclusion and around the lack of black professors actually go to the heart of the fact that some black people just do not want to participate in this kind of space that is designed in this way that still celebrates people like Rhodes who committed crimes on the bodies of their ancestors. And so I'm not surprised really that many, that applicants, for example, for the Rhodes Chair in Race Relations, that has been open with William leaving, that there was only one black person, simply because the name Rhodes is detestable. So we must think about the ways in which spaces are designed, then leads to these issues that we are discussing about underrepresentation.
Professor jumps up when you said that, so please.
Well, I'm obviously not on the selection committee for my successor, but that's not correct that there was only one applicant for the chair from an African background. I also think I'm hugely in favor of diversity and have tried through the years I've been at Oxford to find scholarships to develop degrees that are attractive, and I think they have been. I think there has been very significant success. I think we need to cast our minds a bit wider. It is the case, I stand corrected, that the biggest group of foreign students overtaken Americans now are Chinese students or students from Chinese background. There are about 150 black African students, sorry, African students, I don't know in detail where they're from, in the university at the postgrad level. And the postgrad level is massively more diverse than the undergrad level. So things have changed. There's a lot going on in the university, and I think to picture Oxford as sort of stuck in some kind of aspect of 50 years ago is not a fair representation, but that doesn't undermine at all the importance of moving further. And I think we need to identify key targets that we can go for and that are reachable. And black undergrad or diversity of undergrads are equally important in that.
Thank you. I think in the interest of moving on, we'll look at another question. I look for the gentleman in the glasses there in the second row. Yeah.
I just want to preface my remarks by adding that it's remarkable and retrograde, I think, that we've heard a defense of Rhodes' views on race tonight. As a Rhodes scholar, I'm ashamed that those views are still in circulation. I think we need to front up to the racism of Rhodes, and the question is, what do we do about it? But my question is about the argument that we need to keep symbols up in order to remind ourselves of the wrongs of the past. When there was a call to change the name of Rhodesia to Zimbabwe, and when there was a call to remove Confederate flags in the United States last year, that exact same argument was raised, namely that we need to keep the Confederate flag and the name of Rhodesia in order to remember the wrongs of the past. So my question is, are there any meaningful distinctions, persuasive in this case, between those examples and the Rhodes Must Fall campaign? And if there aren't any meaningful distinctions, would you support keeping Zimbabwe as Rhodesia and keeping up the Confederate flag?
No. Nomenclature is one of the most important things that we have, and it's the right in self-determination to name your own state where you live. So yes, I do disagree. Rhodesia should have changed its name to Zimbabwe. The issue about the objet d'art is that those objects set up symbols within certain communities and are taken away. This is very different. This is a statue that you pass, that you will see, that is there, that is integrated. Now, in other societies, as I stated, some people chose statues to worship around in this whole idea of the idolatry. I've not seen that here. I've seen people nod at the statue of Rhodes, wanting to find out who he is. And this debate in and of itself has been electrifying all around the world about why, who Rhodes was, why Africa is as it is, and indeed why this faculty is as white as it is. So there is a distinction as to nomenclature. There's a distinction to the objects of history that are taken away and develop their own currency. And then there's this statue. Why is it here? What is it there? Why is it there? And why in this institution does it mean so much that it stays? Because if we start removing statues, where does it end?
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Beinart. Did you have something to add to that?
I just wanted to add that obviously some things have changed, but not everything's changed, and it is a judgment about what has changed and what provides continuity and usefulness. Here's an idea, which I have two, in fact. The first is that we create a room in the Ashmolean. The Ashmolean deals with, I mean, it's a hugely visited museum. It deals with almost every empire in the past. It doesn't deal with the British Empire, the biggest, most important, and certainly the most significant to us. So let's have a detailed exhibition around the symbolism of the British Empire. And that's a place where I think the statue could usefully go.
I suppose you raise the interesting question, which is who decides what goes and what doesn't go? Athi, we haven't heard from you in a while, so would you mind answering that?
Yes, I will. I think this is where the distinction, and it's difficult to have these kinds of debates because arguments and words are just invoked to silence the debate from happening in the first place. I think the distinction here about who decides, about what it is about this particular statue, is Oxford University, right? How does Oxford University imagine itself? What does it say? How does it open itself up to become all of these things it aspires to? And how do the people at Oxford want to see Oxford in the future? And while I agree with Professor Bernard that it is in fact this statue that has given us that has brought us here. And I think that that is somewhat true because like he says, trying to do it via the curriculum in English literature would have received far less attention. But I think the point is that we don't need the statue to continue to have the discussion. Everywhere where this is happening, we're connected to a global project of decolonizing institutions of higher learning. And everywhere where the flag has been removed, everywhere where Rhodes' statue has been removed, where statues of, for example, Leopold have been defaced by students, the conversation can happen because the platform that initially is given to the statue drives the issues that we do want to talk about the fact that, like, there are problems in particular institutions, I mean, in particular departments, there are problems in curriculum, there are problems with representation in academics and in the student body. So we don't have to have the statue to have this debate. And
sorry, I'm in the interest of time. Do you mind if we run out to another question? I look for another question. Could I please go to over here? Femi.
Thank you. I just want to preface this by giving a quick statistic, which is personal to myself, about in my college, which is Regent's Park College, we have 2 black people and 5 people from St. Paul's School, for either boys or girls. But moving on from that, I understand that the whole debate is not just about, it's centered around Rhodes and about South Africa, but the colonial project was not just British and it was not just in South Africa. If you look at Franc-African forced labor until the mid-20th century, if you look at the Belgian Free Congo State, it's a much wider debate with a lot of crimes that go through it. And it goes beyond Africa as well. So I'd like to direct a question to Mr. Bigger, who kind of used a reductio ad absurdum argument earlier to say that if we take down Rhodes, we'd have to take down Churchill and this and that and the other. Is the fact that you can say that whilst most people in this room, or a lot of people in this room, may not be aware of the Bengali famine with where 7 to 10 million Indians in rural areas died, whilst Churchill expressly said, Indians breed like rabbits anyway, it doesn't matter. Not illustrative of the one-sided nature to the way that imperialism and the colonial project is taught throughout schools and universities in the country. Thank you.
Professor Bigger.
So that was my point, that all heroes are flawed. I mean, even Mandela now, whom many of us in this country have thought very highly of, in South Africa he's less highly thought of because some of South Africa's current political woes are now being traced back to decisions he made. So Churchill was flawed. I mean, those who know his life know that. He was also great. And the same goes for Lincoln. Could I respond to a couple of remarks that were made
please,
earlier?
Please do, yes.
Okay. I realize that trying to defend Rhodes is not a popular position here. I want to give you 2 reasons why I think it's worth thinking about. So Athi earlier referred to a quotation. This is used by Rhodes Must Fall people a lot. that he is alleged to have made. I prefer land to niggers. Excuse me, I prefer land to niggers, that's right. Is that right? Do you know where that comes from? Rhetorical question. Answer. It comes from an 1897 novel. It's fiction. Next quotation. Just after that, Ntokozo referred to Rhodes's genocide. So that relates to another quotation that Rhodes Must Fall had been using, which is alleged that Rhodes at one point said, one should kill as many niggers as possible. That allegation was first made in a book review in 2006. No biographer records that statement anywhere. It appears the statement was fabricated by the reviewer.
Thank you, Professor Bigger.
Gordon Lasseur, the personal and private secretary of Rhodes, writing his memoirs, which were only eventually published after a long tussle with the Rhodes trustees in 1913, contains an extensive paragraph in which he reports, now granted it's a considerable period after this time, but during the Second Matabele War, the beginning of the Chimurenga, the First Rhodesian War of National Liberation, that Rhodes essentially instructs this officer who has spared these people, why haven't you killed these people? You should in fact have killed them all, because this would have created the correct kind of moral lesson for our enemy. They would have feared us more. Now, whether or not Rhodes said this, and it doesn't actually matter what Rhodes said, Rhodes equipped the British South African Company's troops with the latest machine guns and Martini Henry rifles, not because he wanted them to hunt for hippos, he wanted them to terrorize Africans. And indeed, the application of machine guns, as is reported by any number of contemporary witnesses, produced devastating casualties from the early 1890s through to the end of the 1890s.
Thank you, Professor Drayton. Do you have something substantive to add? If you could, would it be
Yeah, I was just going to say to Nigel, this is why you should stick to theology. Because those who are students of history, including, for example, very ironically, of course, Rhodes Scholar and historian, Adeyeke Adebajo, have written, substantively about Rhodes's actions, which we have always interrogated. We are talking about actions, we are not talking about words. Because there is this essence of reducing conversations about racism to views and what people say, but we are actually talking about structures and we are talking about actions that people put in place. So, if you are going to deny Rhodes' genocides without taking into account people who have written, historians who have written about, for example, his genocidal scorched earth campaigns that killed thousands of people in modern day Zimbabwe and Zambia through the British Southern African Company's police, for example, or the war crimes that Rhodes committed during the South African War with the use of concentration camps, which now have been conceptualized as something that comes with Nazi Germany, but actually, they begin with Rhodes.
Yeah.
This is an example of the crazy reasoning. Concentration camps belong to the Boer War. That they were borrowed from American and Spanish practice by Kitchener. They have nothing to do with Rhodes.
Rhodes initiated the Jameson invasion, which led to the Anglo-Boer War. This is why even white South Africans abhor Rhodes.
Rhodes was responsible for the Boer War and therefore for the concentration camps.
And it wasn't the Boer War, it was the South African War, because black South Africans were involved in it and they did die in it.
He had nothing to do with concentration camps, which you alleged, nothing at all.
Thank you, Professor Bigot. Professor Beinart, did you have something to add to that?
No, just to agree that I do feel that you need to be a bit more cautious about your use of history.
Well, thank you. Yes, I think we'd certainly take more questions. I'd also like this opportunity just to say, sorry, if the panelists don't mind, if we could reduce your closing statements to 1 minute, so we could have more questions from the audience for more time, if everyone's happy with that, if that's okay. Thank you. So look for more questions. We will go right back to the gentleman in the purple jumper, shirt, in the middle.
Thanks. So all heroes are flawed. The thing is, some people aren't heroes, right? So I'd make the radical suggestion that Cecil Rhodes might not be a hero. My question is over here. I'd just love to hear more about your positive vision of what Oxford could look like. Right? What's your sort of image of a more diverse, accepting, post-Rhodes Oxford?
A black woman?
They just said a black woman should say something.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we'd like to see Oxford in the future be a space that is that facilitates and attracts the very best, and not just because, and not the very best based on a prejudice that it holds that those are white European men. We'd like it to be a space wherein everyone can apply to and be competitive based on what it is that they are able to do, and not necessarily because of where they come from or the color of their skin, right? We think it's an important thing for Oxford University, which says it is a leading academic institution, to be able to teach history that is balanced, to be able to teach African studies that is balanced, and to be able to have a curriculum that doesn't erase the history of the rest of the world, and thereby uphold, perpetuate the idea that particular people are worth, have value, and other people do not. Because we think that that's not just a problem for the university, but when the world looks for professionals to solve the world's problems, we need those people to be able to have a balanced reflection of the world in which they exist. Because currently, the world is plagued by all of these problems because we're ruled by an order of white supremacy. And I think that's the thing that this debate exposes and needs to interrogate.
And I think to add to that, there's some concrete things that you can really think into to make it more tangible what we're actually trying to achieve. When I think of African students that have been here for a while, that have maybe started to study for a PhD in their third and their fourth year, something that most of them will say that if they go home, they actually stand as being westernized. They're not able anymore to connect with their families and with their friends back home the way they were before, because people think that they've actually been westernized by Western education. Isn't there any way that we could say that someone who has been in Oxford, studying in Oxford, has been able to get a balanced view of the world and of whatever field he or she is studying that enables him to still connect the way to his home country before, as he was able to before? And at the same time, can we also create a space where we just have more capability to embrace African students and African professors in the university? When I mentioned the example earlier about the African Studies Center, I'm actually not accusing them, because I know that the background processes are actually making it quite hard for them to find a black African professor because of how the university works. Maybe we can change these procedures. And also in terms of what the Africa Society is trying to do, we're currently trying to build up our own scholarship fund for African students, because we know that the university alone can't do enough because of the capacities that have been allocated to this topic. Can we increase that capacity? Because that would help so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We could get another question, please. So we'll try and get... Okay, there's someone who's literally waving at me. So, yeah, the... But, yeah, yes, I will. I'm partly who puts their hands up as well.
Thank you very much for your comments. I want to ask, because as an outsider, it seems hypocritical that a number of Rhodes Scholars are sitting here after having benefited from the Rhodes Scholarship, now denouncing Rhodes' work and his legacy. Then again, I also want to ask, where do you draw the line? That gentleman there with his bust in the Oxford Union is Lord Curzon, responsible personally for perhaps 6.1 to 9.3 million deaths in India. We are in England. England is an imperialist nation responsible for many deaths worldwide. We're actually being hypocritical just by being here, by interacting, by contributing to this nation. Where do you draw the line? I feel that by denouncing Rhodes, we're all actually doing a disservice instead of just getting on with it and trying to contribute positively to the environments we find ourselves in.
So we have Professor Drayton.
Repeatedly in the public prints, attacks, ad hominem attacks have been made on the leaders of Rhodes Must Fall, saying, well, you are Rhodes scholars, how could you possibly be criticizing Rhodes? Let's be quite clear about this. I think that when I was being interviewed for the Rhodes Scholarship, I was asked the question, since you've been involved in the anti-apartheid movement, this was the 1980s, how could you possibly now want to take Mr. Rhodes' money? And I answered exactly in the same way as this gentleman did. I said, well, were I to be elected, my obligation would be to those whose wealth was taken by Mr. Rhodes, not to Mr. Rhodes. To which the Governor General of Barbados, Sir Hugh Springer, chuckled and said, yes, as we say in Barbados, if you thief from a thief, God smile.
Can I just address that, because I think that there has been a backlash against me, particularly because I am on the Rhodes Scholarship, with people invoking very disgusting language, people calling me a dirty little nigger, telling me to go back to the continent, and invoking tropes of the same tropes that basically the likes of Rhodes did. And then you want to tell me that the problem has gone away? Of course the problem hasn't gone away. But the point that I want to make is that those of us from Southern Africa who take the money of the Rhodes Scholarship do so because we are here for the change. We are here to take back the money. We are here to at least have some dignity that we take away from the indignifying dispossession and plunder that the likes of Rhodes committed on the continent. And so I will not be told that I am a hypocrite for taking money that was stolen from my people. And of course, I think it's a way of obfuscating the issue. Rhodes scholars have a proud history of actually interrogating Rhodes' legacy, whether or not they are from Southern Africa. And I think this idea that money can somehow buy our silence is exactly what the problem is. This is exactly what we are confronting. We are confronting these enclaves of privilege in which we have to compromise and cut bits of ourselves in order to enter. We are saying that we will not be silenced through entering into these spaces. And I think it's problematic when a nation that says it is committed to free speech, it is committed to the interrogation of ideas and of histories, then uses those tools like money, which it actually plundered from other parts of the world,
Thank you. To then silence us. Thank you. Sophia.
Thank you.
Yes, I mean, I agree. We agree that education is the way forward, and you should not have to apologize for being a Rhodes Scholar.
Oh, you finally agree, Sophia Cannon. Thank you.
I think it was important that you must have said to people that you were a Rhodes Scholar first, and say that why you are putting forward a position within that framework, and you didn't, and I thought that was dishonest, and you should have let people know that you are a Rhodes Scholar.
So
that you have that part of that legacy, and you turn that legacy around. The thing that I said to you, why I was so frustrated, because as I said, we sang songs about you in the 70s. We were waiting for you to be born. This huge critical nucleus of black minds going from South Africa all the way through Europe, across to the States, down to the Caribbean. This, we've been waiting for you. You get to Oxford and you set about not changing the problems of the African diaspora, you set about moving the furniture. Raise your expectations and change and bring something to this legacy. Be the Rhodes Scholar that he never envisaged you to be, and be better.
I think I'm the Rhodes Scholar he never envisaged to be. Thank
Brilliant.
You.
Brilliant.
Athi, do you want to respond to that? If we could keep it relatively, thank you.
I think this is part of the problem in like existing in an environment where you have to shut yourself out so much that you begin to deny that you have value as well. The idea that like Ntokozo ought, the first thing that he needed to do was say, I'm a Rhodes Scholar in order to have this discussion is precisely the point of this debate. Why does he need to be any part of any kind of positionality, locality, to be able to say, this here is wrong? And it doesn't matter that I'm at Oxford. It doesn't matter that I'm a Rhodes Scholar and get money from that funding. I should, in an institution like Oxford University, be able to take this position and say, this university acts unethically, and it is not right for such and such a thing to be happen. This is the kind of trivializing that I think is important to highlight, that we set about changing the furniture. We're not changing the furniture. All of the things that we are addressing at Oxford University ought to be addressed in all institutions of higher learning, and that is going to change the world, madam.
Sophia, I believe you feel you misrepresented.
The whole issue. Again, I know about the issue of the 18 female black professors. I've personally met so many of them. And one of the things that I said was, the problem isn't the white statue on the outside, it's the white professors on the inside. But when you frame the debate, all people see is the removal rather than you setting about, setting your own legacy. And I did say you do need to have a look at how this looks. Bring the debate to the people. And it has changed. That's the first thing you said, was there aren't enough black students here. I can't believe it's 24. I think the year I applied, there were not, I think there were two. I'm a contemporary of David Lammy. We've known each other for some time, but there were two black Britons at Oxford University. I think it was in 1995. So things have improved. But the problem is, and I think we will join on this, if we do not have some form of, and I dare I say it, positive discrimination, my daughter will not come here, my granddaughter will not come here, because as things will go, the equalisation rate is going to take over 100 years.
Thank you.
That Thanks cannot be right.
I think we're looking for two final questions from the audience in the interest of time. So if we could please look right at the back in the scarf.
All right. Thank you so much for all your comments. I want to shift the conversation back to the comment that we're not doing something positive by challenging that something be removed, and that the movement is a negative one. And I think that's a fundamental narrative that's been shaping RMF for a long time. And I am from Ethiopia and I go to Oriel College. I have never identified as black before I came here to Oxford. When I came here, the first obstacle I had to face was the curriculum. Let me tell you, my program is very diverse. There are only two Brits in it. It's 60 countries represented. That's not the problem. Representation is not Oxford's problem. But when I complained about the curriculum or the things I saw that need to be fundamentally changed, people told me, you're in the wrong place. It's Oxford. I mean, are you going to change Oxford? Oxford has existed since, right? So Oxford has fundamental problems that other universities don't. And I can't speak for universities in the UK or speak for all universities all over the world, but it's has put itself on a pedestal, like Rhodes, and thinks that it cannot be challenged because it's the first of something, or the first Nobel of something went to Oxford. This university exists in the present too, although it has a past. Therefore, let's interrogate the past and allow students to live in the present, because my friends here who've been challenging it were saying, where do we stop? Maybe we won't stop. Maybe we'll go on, because every country has its baggage. Ethiopia has a baggage. I'll be very honest with you. Africa has its own baggage. There are imperial problems in Ethiopia as well. People are challenging them. People are saying, let's not honor this king who did this.
Thank you. So
I'm sorry to go at length, but yeah. Oxford is a fundamental problem. Let's not sugarcoat it by saying 5 more people, 6 more people next year.
Well, thank you for your comment. If you want to respond, move on to another question. I think perhaps it's more beneficial to move on to a different question, but thank you very much for that. If we could please look to just over there with the membership card in the air. Yeah.
I just wanted to ask a question about this argument we've heard a lot about, oh, if you go after one statue, then we'll have to go after all the statues, which, I mean, first of all, that says a lot about our culture, that it's strewn about with unjust figures. I mean, what does that say about the country we are in, right? Second of all, that's exactly what's happening. People are going after symbolism and structures in Harvard and in Princeton and in across the US campuses. People are going after these things in Belgium and in other parts of Europe. People are going after them in South Africa. They brought down the statue and the world didn't end. In fact, it got a lot better. There's been a mass movement called Fees Must Fall in South Africa, thanks to Rhodes Must Fall.
So move to a question, please.
My question is, when we say, well, if you go after one statue, don't we have to go after all of them? Is that not sort of like saying, well, we can't catch all the criminals. We can't go after all the war criminals. And therefore, let's not go after the very most obvious one that is standing over all of us.
That's right. You have a response to that. You have a response to that. Professor Bigger, please.
If we're talking about a statue of someone like Stalin or Pol Pot or Hitler, I'd agree with you. As for the rest of them, they're a morally mixed bunch. So whether it's Churchill or Lincoln or Rhodes, they're not simply criminals. They also achieve great things. So if you want pure heroes, you aren't going to have many.
Thank you, Professor Bigger. If we could look for one final question from the audience. Yes, right there. Yes, you are kind of waving. Thank you.
Good evening. I just wanted to return to the point that the Rhodes statue is a secondary issue. So this is kind of directed at the Rhodes Must Fall panelists. But I would argue that whether the statue remains or falls, Rhodes is always going to have a legacy in Oxford. We have the Rhodes Scholarships, we have the Rhodes Building on South Park Roads, and obviously this debate is going to form part of that. And I will be the first to admit that Oxford is predominantly white, and I can understand why that might make students from minority backgrounds feel uncomfortable, and that is something that as a university we need to work on and change. But I don't feel that removing the statue is going to change that. From my perspective, we need to be working in minority outreach programs and racial awareness workshops. And I think that as students of university, I think our time would be better spent doing that. So I would ask, why is it that we are prioritizing the removal of the statue instead of exploring other avenues such as those initiatives?
Yes, so this is the answer to that before, but we have a short answer to it. This has been answered slightly before, but a short response to that. Do you want to?
So it's interesting, you know, because the Oxford Africa Society has partnered with Rhodes Must Fall, I've said that earlier, and we've partnered on the broad agenda, and the broad agenda was not the removal of a single statue, it was not. The reason why we're having this debate today is because this is what the media has decided to prioritize in the entire discourse that has happened over the past 7 or 8 weeks, but it's not the main goal of Rhodes Must Fall. And at the same time, I would like to ask the lady who just stood up back, why would one thing exclude the other? I mean, at the end of the day, we want to do both. And I think we just have to acknowledge that there's a considerable group of people in this university that has a problem with the Rhodes statue. And if there's that considerable amount of people, then you probably have to consider to remove it and eventually take it down, which is what we've been saying at the protest.
Thank you, Yasmin. I think now we should move to closing statements, if the panelists are happy with that. So as I said, if we could do, I'll do one bell on 1 minute and two bell on 1 minute 30, if that's okay. So, yeah, that's correct. So Ntokozo, please, when you're ready.
Yes, I think if we've achieved anything tonight, then it should be, again, having outlined that not only that RMF has a broad project that goes beyond the statue, but also that statues do go to the very way in which we imagine ourselves. And of course, I think we need to abandon people like Nigel and leave them in the past who, you know, will defend these statues because they go very much to their identity, which they've constructed around this empire, which actually has fallen. There's a reason why, you know, and I'm positive that you, as Oxford students, will take this forward because, you know, there's a reason why there has been support for the movement within Oxford. There's a reason why the University College JCR has decided to rename its Rhodes Computer Room. There's a reason why Oriel College has responded positively to us. So I'm saying that people are responding, and I'm saying that if still, by the end of tonight and by the end of, I think, the impressive case that we've made for Rhodes Must Fall, you still think that Rhodes must stand, or you still click like on those weird Facebook pages that say Rhodes must stand, then the future is moving faster than your consciousness.
Thank you very much, Ntokozo. Yasmin.
So I think one point that we've discussed a lot tonight and that was taken up in one of the last comments is the question, how can we be consistent about the removal of statues? And since this is the main topic of the debate, even though, as you can see, you want to talk about something else, mostly, I think it's important to have a take on that. At the end of the day, you can over-rationalize things quite quickly. And if we said that Rhodes has to stand because he has a historical legacy, from a rational standpoint of view, we would have to apply the same thing in the future. So, for instance, I've discussed an argument with a member of the Africa Society that what if ISIS is gonna take all the money that they get from the oil fields that they still have, put it into an educational trust, and in 100 years there's a scholarship here in Oxford. Would we say that there should be a statue for it just because they have put money into it? It would be the rational application. But no, it's not, because there's a moral consideration to it. And I think the most important thing is that there's students here, a considerable amount, that want the statue to be removed and they need to be heard. At the same time, I'm asking, is Rhodes really history? Is something history once the person has passed away? Or is it history only when we have fully been able to process what the legacy of that person is? And I think we've not been able to when it comes to Rhodes, which is why the statue has maybe been erected too early. At the end of the day, we have institutional racism in Oxford, and I can talk about various stories of AfriSoc members and non-AfriSoc members within the university that have had their personal share. And I'd like everyone to take away that you're all contributing to making the university an egalitarian space. Thank you.
Athi, please, your closing statement.
I've personally not been persuaded by the idea that Rhodes' statue should stay up there for the purposes of retaining a history. I'm worried more after hearing the other side that there is an attachment, an insistence on being privileged in the world. And what that kind of attachment, that kind of insistence, is what has created a global racialized order that gives us the kind of instances we see that devalue the lives of people all over the world. Movements like this at Oxford University, at Cambridge, in universities in the United States, in South Africa, in France, in Belgium, are particularly concerned with that preoccupation of one group of peoples to insist on being privileged in the world. I don't think that Oxford University loses anything near to what we claim is lost by those people who have to exist in this space under the shadow of that statue. And so I urge you, when you do vote, to act ethically, to make the moral consideration, and to think about the way up that this university is faced with when deciding whether or not Rhodes must fall. We say he must fall, take him down.
Thank you very much for that. Professor Drayton, your closing statement, please.
Standing there in the high is an idol to money and earthly power, a monument to a deformed kind of national identity, a symbol of Britain the bully, Britain the slave driver, rather than Britain the emancipator, the maker of peace and justice, Britain the refuge of scholars and trustee of learning. The statue of Rhodes is not a monument to British national greatness. It is a monument to a particular Victorian and Edwardian conjuncture in which a technological arms gap allowed rogues in the name of Britain to take by force what they wanted from the world. It is a monument to mass killings of Africans by machine guns, to generations of semi-slavery imposed on the survivors, to warmongering which helped unsettle European affairs, a monument to human greed and weakness. That monument needs to be put in its context in a museum, not at the center of the cross of the town. You in this room, now mostly in your 20s, women, men of all social and ethnic origins, you are a product of the democratic revolution of the 20th century. A substantial majority of you, if you had been alive in 1911, would not have been in this room. The business of making Britain and the world a juster and more inclusive and more compassionate and more neighborly space, a place where we can all be at home, is still not yet finished. There's work for your generation to do, particularly in Oxford, and the path towards this leads through the removal of Rhodes from the heart of this university.
Before that, Professor Drayton, Professor Barnard, your closing statement, please.
Thanks. It is very heartening for me that the University of Oxford matters to our students and to our students from such a wide range of backgrounds as it matters to me, because I think it is a special place. I support many of the ideas that have been mentioned, and I'd just like to get back to this issue of trying to take forward concretely things that we can do and they're within our grasp. If, as Yasmin says, there are incidents of racism that students encounter, and I have heard of same myself to a degree, we have officers now, we have a Pro Vice Chancellor for Diversity. Let's address them. Let's record them and address them, and I think that the university would benefit from that greatly. The second thing is, I think the university as a whole has to consider the issue of staffing. It's extremely difficult in small little units and in our devolved departments to do this. There needs to be money reserved, and I'm sure there's money that can be found to make, say, a certain amount of diversity appointments. And the university has actually been discussing this already. Studentships. We really can. I mean, we've had tremendous success in recent years. Standard Bank, for example, has just invested in a whole lot. Some of the colleges are going to announce this as well, Students for African Students. And lastly, however, I don't want to leave us with the sense that there hasn't been a lot achieved. I think that next to SOAS in Edinburgh, and I think even to a greater extent, we have trained a generation of Africanists over the last 20 years. And really, this university has been a major center for training of postgraduate students, doctoral students in African studies across many different disciplines.
Thank you for that, Professor Beinart. I now turn to Professor Biggar for your closing statement.
Certainly the most important thing about this debate is the present, not the past. So if indeed there are non-Western texts, for example, that should be on our curricula, then it's up to folk to bring them forward and make the case. Yeah? So there's plenty constructive to be done. As for the statue itself, it's not the end of the world if it comes down. I just don't think that Rhodes is the demonic figure that some people on my right think he is. I still don't think he was racist. Would a racist have put money behind a black political newspaper, as Rhodes did in 1897? Would a racist have defended the black vote in the Cape Parliament in 1899? The continued claims that he was responsible for genocide are nonsense, as claims that he was associated with the concentration camps. He wasn't a demon. He was also very ruthless. And he was reckless. He was involved in a failed coup d'etat. On the plus side, however, he devoted his wealth and his life to public purposes, not only to developing diamond mining, gold mining, banking, agriculture, railways, telegraphs in South Africa, as well as funding his famous scholarship scheme from which 8,000 people have benefited. He's not a saint, he's not a demon either.
Thank you very much for that, Professor. And now finally, Sophia, for your closing statement.
There has been a great deal of pride in this room, and it should be reflected in the youth bringing forward this idea that the structure of our society is not just limited to its architecture, but also the institutions which have supported it for so long. The problem that we face, and I believe Oxford faces, is that the global problems have changed. And if we don't take our diverse voices, these problems aren't going to be solved. The main issue tonight must be the future. Yes, I may be persuaded that if the statue falls, it will not be the end of the world. But equally, we must know our history to know our place. Because if we whitewash our history and remove all vestiges of inequity, superiority, we are not going to understand how we've made those mistakes, and moreover, we are not going to move forward. In relation to the future, somebody asked, how do we see this utopian future for Oxford? Well, I think it's here. Rhodes, perhaps the scholarship, should be utilised to pull the brightest and the best across the world. I talked about redeeming Rhodes. Perhaps this is a way forward. So that a man who did not believe in the black race and in black people, that legacy should be bringing the best and the brightest from the African diaspora.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to everyone on the panel and indeed everyone in the audience. As I said, we will now be voting with our feet, so please be careful with which door you walk out of. In the gallery, you will be directed for the direction. Please remain seated. If you all please remain seated while the panelists leave. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a good evening.